The next item of business is a statement by Derek Mackay on the Provisional Outturn 2015-16. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and there should therefore be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Derek Mackay. You have 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to update Parliament on the Provisional Budget Outturn for the 2015-16 financial year. Before I do so, I would like to address the outcome of last week's EU referendum as it relates to public finances. First, no one can deny the significance of last week's events for our economy, our communities and indeed our constitution. At such a time, it is imperative that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament work together to demonstrate to those we serve that we will continue to manage the public finances competently and in their interests. I commit to working with all members, particularly those in the Finance Committee, to ensure that that is achieved. I welcome the opportunity for discussion at committee this morning. Secondly, we cannot consider the public finances in isolation from the wider economy, particularly in light of the devolution of fiscal powers through the Scotland Act 2016. The First Minister has made clear that we'll take all necessary steps to stabilise and grow Scotland's economy, and this will be a guiding principle in the actions that I will take in managing the Scottish Budget. Scotland is a vibrant country that values greatly the contribution that those from other countries bring, and it presents excellent opportunities for investment and to do business both now and in the future. The Scottish Government is already engaging closely with the business community, delivery partners and a range of other stakeholders to underline our commitment to key programmes, particularly around support for the economy and public services. And finally, I can assure Parliament that the Scottish Government will be engaging closely with HM Treasury and counterparts in Wales and Northern Ireland over the coming months to work together in the interests of our economies and public finances. However, as the First Minister has already said, we will also seek direct engagement with the EU leaders and institutions to further the interests of the people of Scotland. With a forthcoming change of Prime Minister, it is not clear what a future UK government's fiscal plans will be. The Chancellor has already said there will not now be an emergency budget, and that is to be welcomed, but we must not be complacent and assume that nothing will change. It will therefore be important to take appropriate time and consider to be ready to respond. I will consequently be urging my counterparts in the UK government to reflect very carefully on the impact of continuing austerity on our economy, our public services and our communities. We have a duty to be prudent and provide stability at this time. Although there may be no emergency budget, there will inevitably be budget adjustments by the new UK government. The scale of these adjustments we do not know. Presiding Officer, I will now turn to the provisional outturn for 2015-16. Financial year 2015-16 represented the final year of the 2010 UK spending review settlement, which saw the Scottish Government's discretionary budget fall by almost 10% in real terms, and within that, the capital budget fall by almost a quarter. It also represented the first year that the Scottish Parliament became responsible for landfill tax and the land and buildings transaction tax, in being the first finance minister in Scotland for over 300 years to set national taxes. My predecessor adopted a fair and progressive approach to rates and bans. That prudent and principles-based approach to taxation is one I plan to replicate over the course of this Parliament. Under the current devolution settlement, the Scottish Parliament is not allowed to overspend its budget. As a consequence, we have consistently adopted a position of controlling public expenditure to ensure we live within the budget caps that apply, but remain able to carry forward some spending power resources for a future year. That prudent strategy has proven to be the right one, particularly in light of last Friday's events. In 2015-16, the Scottish Government therefore has once again demonstrated a sound grip on the public finances. And I can report that within the fiscal departmental expenditure limit, fiscal DEL, the resources over which this Parliament has discretion, the provisional outturn for 2015-16 is expenditure of £29,160 million against a limit of £29,275 million. This means there is a fiscal DEL cash underspend of £75 million in resource spending and £40 million in capital spending, which represents just 0.4% of the total fiscal DEL budget. Both of these sums are carried forward into 2016-17. There is also a provisional outturn underspend of £40 million in respect of financial transactions, which through rules set by HM Treasury are ring-fenced for loans and equity investment outside the public sector. Again, this is carried forward into 2016-17. Overall, including financial transactions, this means that we will be carrying forward 0.5% of the total 15-16 cash budget. These sums are carried forward using HM's Treasury Budget Exchange Facility agreed in the last spending review. Now, this will ensure that there is no loss of spending power to the Scottish Parliament. Given the considerable uncertainty that has now been created as a result of the EU referendum vote, I do not intend to rush immediate decisions on the deployment of these resources. Instead, I will therefore consider their deployment when it is appropriate to do so, taking account of the prevailing economic conditions and in full consideration of need and spending pressures. Turning to the non-discretionary elements of our budget, the non-cash DEL provision, which I remind Parliament once again cannot be used to purchase goods or deliver public services, based on the provisional outturn position, expenditure is lower than budget by £130 million, which is consistent with previous years, and as the description suggests, these resources are not cash in nature, rather they provide very specific budget cover for differences between estimated accounting adjustments and the final amounts calculated. Over £80 million of the total relates to a lower than expected write-down of the carrying value of the income contingent repayment student loan book. This is an accounting adjustment and has no cash consequences. Other uses for this budget include the depreciation and impairment of assets, all of which have no cash consequence. Finally, under devolved powers from the 2012 Scotland Act, and as I've already indicated, 2015-16 was the first year in which devolved taxes in respect of land and building transactions tax have been managed in Scotland. A total of £572 million has been collected, some £74 million above the initial estimates. Again, recognising the uncertainty that has been created in the economy, I've also decided to take a prudent view of the deployment of these resources. I am mindful in particular of the impact of the EU referendum decision on property transactions and the need to manage potential volatility in future tax revenues. The additional taxes will therefore be placed in the Scottish Cash Reserve, a new facility created by the 2012 Act, which allows excess tax receipts above forecast to be held for later deployment. This will allow me to have greater flexibility and carry these resources forward into 2016-17 and potentially beyond if necessary. I set out my thinking on the budget and spending review process earlier today, and so I will consider the deployment of these tax receipts as part of that process. This statement of the 2015-16 provisional outturn reflects the position against HM Treasury budgetary controls and will be followed by reporting on final outturn against the 2015-16 Budget Act limits and a suite of annual accounts which together report on the total Scottish budget approved by the Scottish Parliament. The annual accounts of the Scottish budget and the Scottish Government and of all individual bodies funded from the Scottish budget will report on their expenditure compared to the allocation by Budget Act. The annual Scottish Government consolidated accounts and a statement of total outturn for the financial year 15-16 against the final budget for the Scottish administration as a whole will be provided to the Scottish Parliament later this year. As we enter a period of considerable uncertainty for both individuals and businesses, it is incumbent on the Government and Parliament to demonstrate strong leadership in managing public finances. And Presiding Officer, we have entered a period of considerable financial and economic turbulence in what was already a challenging climate. The continuing competence that this government has taken to the management of public finances has once again been demonstrated in our management of the 2015-16 budget. That prudent approach has served us well, and so we must not make any rash decisions now. To do so would risk our ability to respond to as yet unknown events. I therefore commend today's figures to Parliament and very much hope that members will join me in commending the approach we are taking.
The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes for that. Then we'll move to the next item of business. It would be helpful if those who wish to ask questions could press the request to speak buttons now, please. There are a lot of members who wish to ask questions, so again, may I ask that questions and answers are succinct. I call Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his statement and for advance sight of it? And can I welcome his comments on the need for stability in the wake of last week's referendum result? The economic fundamentals in the UK are sound, as the Chancellor of the Exchequer made clear earlier this week. And now that a decision has been made, I hope that the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that it is important that all politicians avoid whipping up hysteria about the consequences of leaving the EU. I hope he would also accept that, with the rest of the UK accounting for 64% of Scottish exports, while Europe accounts for just 15%, the greater risk to the Scottish economy comes from any plans his government might have for a second independence referendum. I have two specific questions for the Cabinet Secretary, Presiding Officer. Firstly, one of the largest departmental underspends is in the government's priority area of education and lifelong learning, some £90 million in cash. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain how this figure has been arrived at? And secondly, the Cabinet Secretary refers to LBTT, and he will know that the revenues from domestic LBTT are around some £33 million lower than originally estimated, a lower figure not entirely explained by the forestalling that was occurred at the start of the year. Now, I ask him this question not merely because I am currently in the process of moving house, Presiding Officer, but does he agree with me it is time to look again at LBTT rates to see if a reduction in certain levels might actually increase the tax take?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Myrtle Fraser for his questions. I thought it was quite interesting. He asked me to provide reassurance and calm in this time of uncertainty. And then Myrtle Fraser started whipping up fears and a bit more scaremongering in relation to any other referendum. Can I revert back to what I did at Finance Committee this morning, which is to say the First Minister has explained our constitutional position and the aims and objectives that we are pursuing. But of course, I want to try and deliver calm and stability. And the government's been very proactive in engaging with stakeholders in trying to not just calm people in terms of the position in Scotland, but also seize opportunities that may well exist. And in terms of the doom and gloom, you know, it was the Chancellor himself, George Osborne, outlined a number of the risks to the economy, and some of that is turning out to be accurate. But we all have a shared responsibility now to deliver the best we can for Scotland and its people and its economy. Specifically on education, as with some of the, or many of the budget lines within this, there is a detail behind every specific line. And within that, you know, I can give more information to the member or any other member, but I'll give an example of part of the underspend within education that the member cited. £50 million of accumulated Scottish Funding Council reserves were transferred back to the Scottish Government through cash demand changes. No loss of spending power to either higher or further education sectors, for example. Now, that's quite a substantial figure, and I think just gives a sense of how some of this is the accounting exercise rather than any loss of spending power. And of course, education continues to be a priority for the government, and we propose additional resources to education. Secondly, on the point of general tax, surely it's to be welcomed, even by the Conservatives, that we've generated more income than we had forecast. And in that respect, I will, though, work on a more consensual basis to look at LBTT rates. I think the government had always committed to a review after the first full year. That was welcomed by stakeholders. And I'm happy to commit to taking an inclusive approach to look at the levels of taxation and the rates to make sure that we've got it right. But I think it's fair to say, having exceeded our forecast, that we've done a very effective job so far in those new devolved taxes that have come our way.
Kezia Dugdale.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's words on the impact of the EU referendum and reassure him that the priority of these benches will be to focus on jobs, the economy and workers' rights, and where we can support the government, we will. In an answer to a recent written question, the Finance Secretary advised me that the Scottish Fiscal Commission would not be producing its own independent forecasts until the summer of 2017, and that in the meantime, the government would continue to produce its own forecasts. Can I ask whether the Cabinet Secretary has any plans to revisit this decision in light of last week's referendum results, and whether he is currently confident that he has the data he needs to assess and indeed monitor the impact of Brexit on Scotland's economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think there's now a great deal of uncertainty in the economy that wasn't there before. And for that reason, I outlined to the Finance Committee this morning, I think, why we have to look more closely at budgetary timescales. And we are dependent on a number of forecasts, some from UK government, some from OBR. The Scottish Fiscal Commission will act in an advisory capacity before they take up fuller functions. And I also, at Finance Committee today, have addressed the issue of capacity and support for the Fiscal Commission. So I'm satisfied that I have as much as can be given at this time, but there is now a new level of uncertainty that has been generated. But we'll work very hard on reciprocal arrangements with UK government and working with the other devolved administrations as well to put ourselves on the strongest possible footing to understand the impact of proposed exit and therefore to respond.
Michael Russell, to be followed by Alex Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Clearly, these figures show a commendably tight financial management, given that the variation is only 0.5% of total fiscal del. But as both earlier questions have referred to, there are troubles ahead. It is obviously right that all options are examined. In terms of those options, perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could say a little more about the cash reserve process. It is encouraging to know that we now have the opportunity to create that reserve. It would be useful to know under what conditions that reserve can be used and what his own policies and plans are for using that should it become necessary.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's fair to say I've inherited a strong position from my predecessor, and the 0.5% underspend is to be welcomed in that any available other resources that have been carried forward can be deployed in a way that we think is appropriate going forward. And that's why I'm not making any spending announcements today, just days after the Brexit decision, and considering the uncertainty that exists. But the cash reserve allows us, where we've raised more tax than has been forecast, to put that into that reserve. That's what I'm proposing to do, and we can draw upon that as and when required. But the constitutional position and the financial and the fiscal position of the Scottish Government and this Parliament continues to evolve as full implementation of the last Scotland Act is delivered. So we have increasingly more flexibility to use the carry forward and indeed the cash reserve. And the kind of issues that we would want to consider is if we don't meet any future income targets. Now that may be possible because of the impact on the property market, so that may impact on LBTT or indeed income tax, on which we will be more heavily reliant. So I'll consider the taxes that are being generated and the pressures on public expenditure as well, and how we respond to the pressure on our country as a consequence of the outcome of the referendum whilst pursuing the government's objective.
Alex Johnson, followed by Willie Coffey.
I note in the supporting documents under the heading Health, Wellbeing and Sport an overspend of £128 million. Could I ask the Minister if he can explain whether this reflects the growing problem of deficits within a number of Scottish health boards, and furthermore, whether this high figure, outstanding high figure in the document, indicates a growing problem which may destabilise budgets in coming years?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't think that's a fair characterisation at all. And again, as with the education question, I'm happy to give more specifically on an almost line-by-line analysis on this particular issue. But if you take health and the particular spend there, there has been an issue around classification on ONS and other matters in relation to capital. So I think it's very important we focus on the detail here and understanding the difference between, of course, revenue and capital. And I'm happy to write to the member with a fuller position here and say that I'm sure with the Health Secretary we'll pay close attention to these matters. But no, I don't accept that characterisation. There are specific classification issues that I'm happy to give in much fuller detail to the member if that's of assistance.
Willie Coffey, followed by James Kelly.
Thank you. Could the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the Scottish cash reserves can and will be used to support our public finances and public services during this period of economic turbulence, which is caused entirely by this shambolic UK Tory government?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it must be reassuring that any underspend, we have the ability to carry it forward. That wasn't always the case, and with the specific cash reserve, and these are only provisional figures, with the specific cash reserve, then we will be able to draw upon that, and we have a great deal of flexibility. So I think it's the right thing to do, not to rush to new spending decisions, but take a prudent and cautious approach in light of circumstances and use the mechanical, the financial flexibility that this government now has.
James Kelly, followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. I note from the documentation provided that there's a £67 million cash underspend in the community's portfolio, which includes housing. This comes on the back of yesterday's statistics showing that over 5,000 children are staying in temporary accommodation. I'm sure that me, the Cabinet Secretary, finds that unacceptable, and I would ask that he look at how the cash reserve can be managed to address this situation and ensure that our children are not staying in vulnerable and insecure situations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let me respond to that. I think that was the first immediate bid for access to the cash reserve, and it was only a matter of time. But of course, we'll consider all these issues when we take forward our spending proposals through the budget, and if earlier than that is required, then we'll do that. But I take very seriously the challenge that's been identified, and of course supporting people through this period of austerity and difficult times, and we'll be very mindful of the choices that we make with available resources.
Patrick Harvey, to be followed by Ivan McKee.
Thank you, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the advance copy of the statement. Normally, there might be great value in having relatively low level of underspend, but we face the strong possibility in the future not only of further cuts coming from Westminster, but also of increased procurement costs right across the public sector as a result of the low value of the pound. Would it be a useful exercise, and has the government begun to undertake it, to assess the impact on procurement costs in the public sector as a result of that circumstance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Mr. Harvey's right to raise that as one of many issues now of uncertainty that we will have to wrestle with. It will have an impact on procurement and borrowing costs, and will inevitably lead into impacts on the capital plan and other choices that we'll be able to make. We're looking at a range of analysis at the moment. Some of the impact is clearly yet unknown as the markets settle. So it is one of the areas we're actively looking at, as well as a whole host of other funding streams that deliver services in Scotland. Of course, many of them relate to EU funds as well, so we'll have to consider all these matters in the round.
Ivan McKee, followed by Willie Rennie.
Yeah, I can ask the Cabinet Secretary what measures the Scottish Government will take to support economic growth and help Scotland weather the economic shocks caused by Brexit.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Government had outlined our economic strategy, which did include a focus on internationalisation and innovation and infrastructure-led recovery as well. And clearly, they'll all be impacted by the outcome of the decision, but we'll still focus on delivering the manifesto in which we were elected. We have made some announcements on the review of the enterprise agencies. We'll continue enabling infrastructure investment, and that includes digital as well. We've had a competitive rates scheme, and we've delivered on modern apprentices. So we'll look at how we can support the economy, deliver stability, and take advantage of any opportunity that may exist in these uncertain times.
Willie Rennie, followed by Dean Lockhart.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance copy of his statement? Can he provide some information as to why the financial transaction arrangements, the budget, has been underspent more this year than in previous years? He's also rightly warning about the potential cuts as a result of Brexit. So therefore, will he reconsider the government's approach to the use of income tax powers, because he did talk about using all necessary means in order to deal with the troubles ahead. So would he consider a more expansive use of the income tax powers?
Cabinet Secretary.
On financial transactions, some of that might be to do with the uptake of particular schemes and the complexity of that. Again, I'm happy to provide further information. We will have to take a strategic approach to the budget process itself. What I announced and engaged with the Finance Committee on this morning was my view that we should take first a one-year budget to Parliament. I think a three-year spending review would not be wise in the circumstances. But when I approach that budget process, I will engage with all political parties and, of course, hear what each political party has to say in terms of spending choices and tax choices as well. We did outline our position on tax at the Scottish Parliament election. We were elected on that mandate. But I think with the degree of uncertainty that now exists, of course we will have to look at the financial pressures that we face with the decisions of a Chancellor, whoever that may be. I spoke to the Chancellor this morning, so it may be George Osborne, it might be George Osborne's successor, but we will have to look at the autumn statement to see what the UK government does in terms of their spending decisions as well and their tax decisions and the impact in Scotland. But we aim to see through the manifesto in which we were elected, but I'm happy to engage with all political parties to secure the passage of the budget through Parliament.
Dean Lockhart, followed by Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for the advance copy of his statement. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the competence of the government in managing public finances. However, given the significant number of cost overruns experienced in recent IT and other projects overseen by the government and government agencies, including the system for EU farm payments, NHS 24, Police Scotland, and in other areas, can the Cabinet Secretary please confirm the total amount of additional expenditure spent by the government and government agencies as a result of these cost overruns?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't have such a figure to hand, but of course we take very seriously our duty to look after the public finances, deliver good, solid public services, and deliver sound procurement. And I'm happy to discuss further some of the challenges that we've had around some of those schemes, but where we have had challenges, we've tried to recover the position to deliver the best we can for Scotland and fundamentally deliver for our people in some of the areas that have been identified. We're working in all areas that have been identified. We're working very hard to recover our position.
Kate Forbes, followed by Daniel Johnson.
Okay. Briefly, before my question, I'll mention that the First Minister has appointed me to serve the Scottish Parliament as Parliamentary Liaison Officer for the Cabinet Secretary. Brexit poses a number of challenges, specifically for the forecasting of tax revenues. So what steps is the government taking to ensure that we continue to manage tax volatility during these turbulent times?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have engaged with the Chancellor and UK Government and HM Treasury so that there is that reciprocal arrangement around information and that degree of pragmatic cooperation, because we are still dependent on a number of UK factors. But the specific decisions that I've taken, that I've brought to Parliament today around the use of the underspend and the allocation to the cash reserve, I think shows we're taking a sound and prudent and cautious approach, but giving ourselves the ability as a government and as a Parliament to respond in due course. And in terms of the forecast, with that level of uncertainty, a number of things will change. And we do not yet know the impact on our devolved taxes, never mind the UK taxes, but it was the Chancellor who said that he thought that the UK would be poorer as a result and that taxes would be likely to go up and public spending would be likely to go down. And I think that's very concerning for all of us, knowing that austerity will be prolonged. Now, we'll make the best assessment we can of that. I'll come back to Parliament, but fundamentally make the right decisions in delivering both stability and protection in very challenging circumstances.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by Ash Denham.
Uh, Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note Dean Lockett's previous question about general cost of overruns of IT projects, but I note within the Rural Affairs, Food and the Environment line items, there's £46 million worth of overspend in financial transactions. We, of course, note with concern the issues that have been faced with the administration of CAP payments, and I was wondering if the Cabinet Secretary had detail of what amount of that figure, or indeed other figures in these line items, are attributable to those issues faced by that department.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, I'm happy to engage on the fine detail of that specific issue. In terms of the spending, the overspend on £54 million on financial transactions reflects the loans in respect of less favoured area support scheme, which will be recouped in 16-17. But I'm happy to come back on the detail of that particular portfolio rather than take even more time to try and explain it across the chamber.
And our last question on this statement is to Ash Denham.
What steps will the Scottish Government take to provide businesses with the reassurance and certainty during the current precarious economic climate to help ensure we continue to attract investment and build a strong and competitive Scottish economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the first thing we want to do, of course, is to ensure our continuing place within the EU and to seek the opportunities that that would bring for Scotland. We'll engage with stakeholders and business. And just hours after the result, Cabinet Secretaries were engaging in meetings and dialogue with key stakeholders to provide that stability and reassurance, but also to hear from stakeholders what we could do and what could be done to give further support at this time. Scotland's economy is fundamentally strong, and there are great opportunities ahead despite the uncertainty that has now been created. So we'll continue to recalibrate our efforts to deliver that stability, that economic opportunity, and although the climate in which we're operating has changed, to deliver on the government's economic strategy which has been previously outlined to Parliament. And I'll continue to engage with all relevant parties to take forward our agenda.
Thank you very much. That ends questions on the statement. I'll allow a minute or so for the front bench to change over.